If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this post-Christmas episode.
Oh, yeah. Pre-New Year's.
Mind Pump. For the first 30 minutes during our intro, Adam, Justin, and myself have some interesting conversation. First, we talk about Christmas. What we got for Christmas, what we bought for Christmas, what we got our kids for Christmas, what Adam got for Christmas. It's a good conversation. Then we talk about Justin's climbing wall project.
Oh, shit.
He actually built a room for his kids for Christmas.
It's like a McDonald's playhouse.
Makes me feel like less of a father.
Gotta get him strong, man.
We talk a lot about Snatch in this episode.
Oh, yeah.
The movie, not the vagina.
Yeah. We
talk about Thrive Market and Dr. Bronner's soap. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. By the way, we are sponsored by Thrive Market. We have an incredible hookup set up with them. This is what you do. Go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump.
Hooking you up.
You will get 1 month free membership, $20 off your first three orders of $49 or more. So that's like a $60 credit and free shipping. We also mentioned Organifi Cacao and their gold drink.
Cacao!
We are also sponsored by Organifi. If you go to OrganifiShop.com, enter the code MINDPUMP for a tremendous discount. We talk about the Density Blanket. This is a weighted blanket for anxiety. Never tried one before.
You are my density.
But it sounds interesting. We talk about Adam's unfortunate Achilles injury, saving a baby from traffic.
That's right.
That lucky baby.
Somebody had to do it.
We talked about divorced parents working together for the benefit of their kids. It's way more difficult than it sounds. I'm experiencing it right now. Then we get into the questions. The first question was, we talk about eating healthy and intuitively all the time. What kind of advice can we provide to someone whose palate simply doesn't like healthy foods?
This will motivate Doug to get our
kicking in the dick.
Our food book coming here, right? Our cookbook.
Oh, cookbook, yeah. Because this person
I feel like everyone's screaming for it, man.
I think so, you know. Yeah. How can we get healthy food to taste better than Cheez-Its and Lucky Charms? Next question was, we all have goals for 2018. What are they? How are we going to accomplish them? Then we talk about Gary Vee. He's the social media phenom, motivational speaker guy.
Sal loves to poke at him.
We talked about him, his methods, how cool he is, some of the stuff we don't like. Hey, Gary Vee, come on Mind Pump. Finally, final question. Navy SEALs, military professionals, these guys are ripped, but they also do tons of endurance. And we talk all the time about how endurance training will make you lose muscle. What the fuck's going on?
Yeah.
Are we full of shit?
Are we bro scientists?
Yeah, are we bro scientists? Or are we, as we believe, the most intelligent people in fitness? Also, this episode,
Can we make that claim?
I think you're right.
I believe this episode is dropping today, so here's what you're going to do, because I know what's going to happen. This is what's going to happen.
It's a big deal right here. Listen up.
You're going to have your New Year's party. You're going to get hammered. You're going to have a good time. You're going to wake up the next day. And then you're going to feel terrible about yourself.
Because you missed something. You missed something. Yeah. You missed the boat.
You're going to miss something, but you're also going to feel bad because, you know, you partied. Yeah. You had a good time at Christmas. And you're going to say to yourself, you know what? 2018, I'm going to get ripped. I'm going to get healthy. I'm going to get sexy. I'm going to look good. I'm going to do it right. Then you're going to walk into the gym, and then you're going to forget that you don't have a fucking plan. You have no idea what you're going
to
do.
Oh, my God. Where do I begin?
This is what you do. You go to mindpumpmedia.com. You enroll in the MAPS Super Bundle. You will literally have all of 2018 planned out for you with the Super Bundle. You'll have what you need to do every single week. You'll know when you go to the gym, what exercises to do, how many reps, what the tempo looks like. You'll know what adaptations you're aiming for, whether it be mobility or strength or muscle or symmetry or aesthetics. You will have everything set up and planned out for you, including a correctional component, because if you do this right and you train right for the whole year, your body will change the entire time. You will also encounter issues where you need to work on correcting muscle imbalances to prevent injury, because what stops most people in their tracks when they get on this fitness kick is an injury or pain. Now they can't go to the gym. Now they stop and forget it. Now they don't want to go back. Well, the MAPS Super Bundle also includes MAPS Prime, which is our correctional exercise component. Also, if you enroll before 2018, you'll get an offer for half off the forum, and when you get that, you're in our forum for life. That means you never have to enroll again. Now, in 2018, our forum will have an annual fee. So you can avoid that annual fee by doing this right this second. Again, the place to enroll in the MAP Super Bowl and will take advantage of all of this is mindpumpmedia.com.
And it's t-shirt time.
T-shirt time.
How many reviews this time, Doug?
13.
Mm.
Ooh,
that's a little low.
A lot of people eating ham and prime rib and whatever else is going down.
Christmas turkey.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
Bunch of turkeys.
But we're giving out 4 shirts. Going to JewBear, 118. Jordan Coughlin, Jackie K12, Sammy June E. All of you are winners. Send the name I just read to iTunes at mindpumpmedia.com. Send your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
Thank winner,
you,
winner, chicken dinner.
All right.
Pull up your mic and pull up your pants. Let's get podcasting, Justin.
Let's get physical.
Podcasting.
Let's get physical.
Everybody, let's go. Yeah.
Listen.
Oh, shit.
Man, merry motherfucking Christmas, right?
Yeah.
Merry Christmas, man.
Fucking Santa.
It's another one in the books, man.
Right?
Yeah. God, you realize how many Christmases you've seen?
Seen, like, in our lifetime?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's happened a few times.
It's been a lot.
Huh?
It's been a lot, man.
It's pretty easy to keep track of them.
It's, what do you mean? Great.
Yeah, I'm like, yeah. Yeah.
It's been a lot of Christmases, man. How was yours, Justin? Fingers. How are the boys? Were they excited with their Santa gifts?
Yeah, you know, like, we did really well as far as the gifts were concerned. Like,
I don't know if I posted the right ones.
Well, I posted that. I kind of just decided to build, like, a whole jungle gym.
Oh,
dude,
yeah.
Downstairs.
Why are you trying to fucking make all the other dads look bad? That's the coolest.
Why is that, like, so out of the ordinary? Like, that was, like, an idea that I've been trying to do forever.
You built...
Did you see the one on Facebook where the kid did it up the stair, all the way up the stairs?
See, I didn't go that crazy. It was like...
But that was pretty dope.
So it's a whole room...
It's rad. Some people are really creative.
So it's a whole room dedicated to, like, rock, you know, wall climbing.
Yeah, well, a corner of it. I mean, we're going to kind of expand as we go, but, like, it's like the playroom. Because, like, you know, what I use it for originally was mainly just storage and shit. So I'm like, I got to get rid of all this stuff, you know, like, so that way they have a place where they can go. And they're super stoked. They're in there, like, already, like, improving on, like, everything. It was crazy to watch.
What did you put on the floor to, like, if they fall?
Yeah, I have, like, these tiles, like, foam tiles.
I put spikes.
Yeah.
He's like, my kids
got some crocodiles, fire, and
I put real lava.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's really, like, cool, bro.
Get stronger, die.
Yeah.
That is so cool, man.
Yeah.
I want to go in there and hang on shit. I'm too big, though.
Now, are they using it right away or what?
Totally. Yeah, it was funny.
So great.
I was actually a little worried because we were coming back from Christmas. It was actually before Christmas Eve, but, like, we were walking up the stairs because, like, it's at the bottom of my house and, like, you can kind of look into that room. And he saw some stuff kind of hanging. He's like, what's going on down there?
You try to set it up as a surprise?
Yeah.
Was it Santa?
Oh.
Yeah, I pulled it off.
How the hell did you do that?
Because I had my wife take them to the park. I had, like, 4 hours to get all that, like, situated. So I had been building the rock climbing wall with my dad at his shop, and then installed it, and then did all the monkey bars and stuff.
Oh, so you guys didn't do it on the actual? Well, I guess you wouldn't do that on the drywall. That would make no sense. You had to do plywood,
and then
drill it in the
studs. Yeah.
Oh, okay,
yeah, same thing.
Well, that was a project, dude.
It was a project, dude.
Serious,
like,
dad,
I was like,
serious dad project,
dude.
Right there.
And I was sweating because, like, they were around the corner, and this, my wife's like, I can't keep them out anymore. Like, I have to come home. I'm like, oh shit. Like, she's like, I'm like, let me just clean up some stuff. And I'm like, you know, like, all trying to get it in last second. So
was it part of their Christmas gift?
Uh-huh.
Oh, that's great. Was it from Santa or was it from you guys?
That one was from us. So, yeah, that was from us. And then, dude, it was kind of an interesting ordeal because it was both good. So that was a great present and all that. And then we got them a bunch of other cool stuff. But one of the other things was we got them these scooters. And like the Razor ones, but mm-hmm. It was like a nice one. And so, like, I'm scrambling to get all that together, and, like, I fucking broke one.
Oh, did you try riding it?
No, I was just trying to assemble. It's supposed to be like this pop assembly, and I opened it and just went snap, and I snapped, like, the fork off of it.
Oh, shit.
And I felt like, so it was, like, good, and then, horrible. You know, so I actually put that into my shed and like they didn't get that this year. I'm waiting for the new one to get like delivered. So that sucks, dude.
But how do you guys, and now when you have kids, like especially, do you guys do like one big gift and then a bunch of little gifts, or is it like all medium gift? Like how do you guys decide like how you get your kids?
So
gifts?
I didn't realize that it can be different from family to, because you know, oh, you do your sure. own, you do your own thing, you know, every year. And I for whatever reason, I of course everybody does it different, but I just didn't think that. I thought it was kind of the same. So my
like there
girlfriend
was like a standard Santa rule.
Yeah. So my yeah. so my girlfriend's mom is English. She's from England, and my girlfriend lived in England for a while. And I guess the way they do it over there, at least I think, is when kids wake up, there's a big sack that is filled with tons of gifts, and all the gifts are wrapped from Santa, and there's lots of smaller gifts from Santa. So you wake up as a kid, you go downstairs, you open up the sack, and it's like 5 or 6 or 7 of these, you know, smaller, you know, nice kind of gifts, and you unwrap them. Now, when I was a kid, Santa gifts were not wrapped.
Really?
No. And what my mom used to do is take them out of the box and put them, because it looked more real.
Oh, you know what's funny? That's actually what my parents did when I was little. There was always like a bike or a desk, or there was something that was assembled and already there.
There.
And it was not.
Yeah, that was supposed maybe to be the scooter for
maybe
us.
A bow,
yeah,
maybe so a bow on it or something, but never.
Yeah, so that's what we do. And then it was only one gift. So when I was a kid, I'd come downstairs, I'd get one big gift from Santa. Whereas my girlfriend's family did a bunch of little gifts. So that's kind of different.
Well, we do the little gifts in the stocking, too. So you'd like kind of like just spill out or whatever. But yeah, well, that was all the little gifts with Santa and then that one thing.
See, this will probably be the last year that my kids will get a Santa gift, because my daughter now is 8. Mm. So she's going to figure it out. So
does that mean you guys save a ton of money, since that was the big gift, that you guys don't have to do that anymore?
Pretty much. Pretty much. You know, it's funny, though. So I was thinking, so my son told me, he's like, man, he goes, I want you to have more kids so I can keep getting a Santa gift. And I started laughing. And I remember, so when I was a kid, I got a Santa gift till I was like 16, because I'm the oldest of 4. So I'm like this teenager, you know, walking down the stairs. I'm like, oh, cool, I get another gift from Santa. Yeah, no, so. Santa.
You're like, I'll play along with this bullshit.
Fuck yeah. Yeah. I'm not going to reveal this. Yeah. I love my Santa gifts.
Give
no,
it to
but,
me, you jelly jackass.
And then do you guys actually like budget for each kid individually so it's like fair, or do you guys not even worry about that?
We kind of roughly have a budget, but not really. I mean, it's what they want, you know. So
because sometimes what happens, especially when you have girl boy and they start getting to a certain age, there's like this huge discrepancy in like who wants things. Like maybe your daughter, the things that she wants are just not that expensive, but she really wants them. And then you have your son who like wants something like super like a video, like a gaming console these days are like $400 or $500 or something.
You know, I'm lucky. My kids aren't too jealous of each other with stuff like that. Like I was like that. Like my siblings would get things and I didn't have a problem. Although I know a lot of kids that have issues. Like it has to be the same. It has to be like, she got 2 things, so I want 2 things.
Right, right. No, yeah. I know kids are like that. Mm-hmm. That's why I was wondering if you guys had to police that or deal with that at all.
A little bit. Yeah. There's a little bit of like, well, he got, only if it's like 2 guns or, you know, something like that where they can play with each other, you know, and like things like that. Otherwise, yeah, it's just like, here, you have this, you have this. You know?
Dude, the Nerf gun game is like on another level these days.
So my little cousin.
I have so much fun with that shit.
Dude.
Yeah.
My cousin, my little nephew was opening up presents and everyone got on these badass Nerf. I'm like, man, they did not have this level.
No,
like,
dude.
Fully automatic, shoots like 90 feet fucking.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. My cousin has one. My cousin has one.
They're accurate as hell,
It looks like the gun from Predator.
Like the Gatling gun.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he got the same one, dude.
You hold it out your hip, and it's like... Yeah, dude, it's legit.
He's got one of those, and then he got like a pump shotgun one.
What does it shoot?
It shoots darts.
Just one dart?
Yeah, it shoots one dart.
Oh, I want a shotgun that shoots like... Yeah. Multiple darts.
Dude, they're cool, man.
That'd be pretty sick.
Right?
So I want to talk to you guys about Snatch.
Whoa. Snatch?
The movie. Have you guys seen the movie Snatch? I got you guys excited for a second.
Talk about Snatch,
Where are we going here?
Dude, I've never seen that movie before.
Shut up.
Are you serious?
Me and my girl.
Where the hell have you been?
Right.
Well, we were hanging out.
It's only from like 1999.
We were hanging out, and we're like, let's watch an older movie that we know people have said we should watch that we've never watched. So we're, she's like, have you seen this? And I'm like, yeah. And I'm like, ah, oh, you know, have you seen it? So Snatch, neither
that's
one of us
really
has seen it.
That's actually really fun to do something like that.
What a great movie.
It's a great movie.
It's amazing.
It's so well made.
That's one of those movies that I've actually seen a ton of times. It's so
I want to watch it again.
Yeah.
For sure.
And it's better each time because there's so many little things in that movie.
You can't understand them. And right. Then it starts to like.
You spend the first half just trying to listen to what Brad Pitt's saying because you can't figure it out. Then you go back and there's like these little subtle jokes everywhere in the movie and you're like, oh, it's even better time two.
So are there any other movies you can recommend that you guys think I should I've never seen The Big Lebowski.
Another classic.
Yeah, that's like one of my all-time favorites.
Come to my next time you're at my house, we'll go through my DVD collection and you show
me. We'll do a White Russian I'll watch it with you and we'll have a White Russian.
Have you seen Arlington Road?
No.
Put that on your list for you and girl.
Okay.
Tim Robbins, Arlington Road.
Okay.
And if you like fucking twisted movies and like kind of like can't figure it out type of deal, watch that movie.
Okay.
You'll like that.
Yeah, because we were on, what was it? What were we watching it on? Was it Netflix or it might have been Netflix, but we're going through, oh, no. It was on my DirecTV or whatever. And they had a section of critically acclaimed films. So that's the section we were going through.
Oh, I see.
She's never seen, not Platoon. What's the other one? Apocalypse Now.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm not sure if I should show her that, though. That's a disturbing movie, but it's good, though.
Yeah, my girl doesn't like those.
Have you seen Apocalypse Now?
Yeah,
it's a classic.
It is.
The way that they shoot it.
That, Hamburger Hill, and Platoon. They're all ones you got to watch. Once I've seen that, I like
Full Metal Jacket.
Or Full Metal Jacket, all those.
That one's disturbing.
It is, but it's a good movie.
Yeah, so I want to find some more of these critically acclaimed old films that I've never seen for whatever reason. You know, so we can watch.
Did one of you guys take all of the Thrive Market stuff away? Did you guys take
Did you guys have the cacao?
No, I haven't tried it. That's why I was wanting to know if you took it away.
Bro, the cacao's legit. Yes.
The Organifi one?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Yes. I was talking about Thrive Market.
No. Oh, you're talking about the other one.
We had a box of all of our stuff. I want to make like a little pantry or something because we're getting so much Thrive Market and I've seen boxes all over. If we can get like a little thing to organize it, whether it be a cupboard.
This is the Dr. Broner's. Dude, you know what's funny? If you guys ever looked at like the Dr. Broner soap that they sell on Thrive Market?
Yeah.
Have you actually read the label?
It's like all writing, right?
It's fucking weird. Yeah. No. Like honestly, have you guys read
it? No, I haven't read it.
Let me just read a little excerpt. 12th. God bless the persecuted. They alone are his chosen people. Those that did not suffer from the persecution remain short-sighted, small. Only those who united work hard to survive ice age persecution evolved into human beings. It goes on and on and on and on.
Is this on the label?
On a bar of soap?
Yes. Yes. You know, I was like, what in the fuck?
You know which one he's talking about, right?
And I love the soap, too. It's so weird.
You ever seen the soap? I know you've seen it. It's like you'll get the soaps, and they sell different sizes, and it's like the label is all like writing, and then they'll say like Dr. Broner's, and it looks old school.
Do yourself a favor and read the label.
Yeah. I've never read the whole label.
I've never read the label either.
It's just rantings of like, you know, ideas.
You know when that would have come in handy?
Huh.
Pre-smartphone. Remember when you would take a shit and you had nothing to read?
Yeah, you had something to read. Yeah, I think that's what he was going for.
You'd read shampoo bottles and stuff like that.
Just like rants about like the most random stuff and like his philosophy and like, it's interesting.
No, so I was talking to you guys about the
cacao from Organifi.
Really good.
Did we get the box in?
We have the yellow, the gold.
Oh, yeah. I haven't had the gold yet. I haven't had any of that. Finally came in.
I got one of the golds. I went and snagged one for you guys.
So how is it?
It's great. It's really good.
Gold, as I told you, I've been telling you guys about gold.
I've been waiting for it.
So the cool thing about cacao's got some pretty awesome health properties. But it has something in it that's similar to caffeine. Theobromine, am I saying it right? I think that's how you say it.
Theobromine,
I believe so. Sure. It's similar to caffeine, and when you combine it with caffeine, you get this kind of additive stimulatory effect. So cacao in your coffee, great mix, and of course it tastes good. But the Organifi one is just, it's fucking delicious.
I know I've seen a bunch of people on our forum and on the Instagram, so that posting all about it saying it's really good. I was how do these other people got this before we do?
Yeah, it's theobromine. I did say it right.
Yes.
I never fuck up.
So this,
or if I do, we delete it, right?
The soap you're talking about, Justin, that's from Thrive Market, though.
Yeah, so.
Now, was that part of Doug's unwrapping when he sends us kids?
No, I buy it, too, on my own. Like, we'd load up our house with all that Dr. Broner's for, like, dish soap, for shower gel soap.
You've never seen this soap?
Oh, I have seen
that. The, pure Castile soap and all that.
I have seen that soap.
This is what we use at home for the most part.
And I've never read the label.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, who's going to read that?
I know. Well, you know why? Because I was taking a shit and I just like, I was like, it's right there. And I started reading it. I was like, oh my God. Like, what? Have I not like read this before? This is so weird.
You were taken aback a little bit, going back to the old school.
Totally.
Reading the label.
Did you guys get stuff for, you know, the wives and girls? Like, what do you guys do for Christmas? Do you guys do something traditional or do you guys do something different every year? Do you do gifts?
Dude, this year I kind of screwed up too because
no, what'd you do?
I bought her something she obviously wanted. And then I always do something kind of like, so I usually do like two gifts. So there's one that's like somewhat medium, and then you know that she's expecting, and then I'll do another one that I just want to kind of throw her off. And so I bought this density blanket, which is like it's a cool thing. Like you,
is this a weighted one?
Anti-anxiety, yeah. Mm. And so you know she's. She's been going through a lot. I think it was one of those things that was an obvious choice for me, and so I bought it. And I guess what happened was like it didn't fully go through or something. I didn't get like a tracking number.
Oh, that happened to me one year.
And I was what like, they do is they send expecting a, it they like send day
a,
of.
They send a confirmation if you don't say yes to that you got that you confirm that the order's coming through your email fast enough. They'll just cancel.
Then they just cancel it. That happened to me
one Christmas, dude. Yeah. It fucked me, dude. I had some Christians coming from overseas to her, and I thought it was gonna be showing up any day.
Yeah,
and
then it was like, I was still waiting
like
on
a big gift, too.
Yeah.
And I was like, fuck.
Oh man, I feel like such an asshole. So I'm gonna have to make up for that.
Explain a density blanket. I've never even heard of that before.
It's a heavy weighted blanket.
It's like 15, 20, or 25 pounds. Yeah, no, it's like I don't know what kind of foam or like beads or whatever they fill it up with, but
so when you have weight on you, like it can calm you down. It can make you feel like you're being held or whatever. Similar to when you swaddle,
right?
When you mm-hmm. swaddle a kid,
I'm sure that's what that feeling goes back
to. It's actually statistically, well, they've done studies to show that it actually works for a lot of people. Well, so they're blowing up. They're selling a shit ton of them.
And they're really nice quality. And I don't know. I was recommended this one of my clients because, like, yeah, Courtney's been dealing with a lot of anxiety and stuff. So I was like, this is a no-brainer.
It's relatively new.
I haven't heard of it.
Yeah, I hadn't heard of it either. Who sells them? Like, where do you get them?
It's called Density Blankets, I think. Like
straight up website by itself. There's no like this isn't like Bed Bath and Beyond and go get myself.
Yeah,
a density
no, it's off the website. Yeah.
How did you first hear about it?
It was one of my clients like recommended it. Mm. So yeah,
I read an article. She loves it. I actually read an article on them a while ago in I want to say Psychology Today, and they talked about how they actually are effective. They actually work. I think the way they discovered it was people started self. Kind of helping themselves by putting like multiple blankets on so that they have that weight.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's actually supposed to work pretty well. It's like it reminds me of the Thunder Vest for dogs. Thunder Vest for dogs?
yeah, it does.
You know what I mean?
It makes it so my dogs, like just having like a fitted t-shirt on them when we leave and go like somewhere for 4 or 5 hours or the day, they do better. It's hilarious.
Yeah.
By keeping clothes on them, just having they feel
supported.
Feel safer, more comfortable, whatever it is. But when they're no shirt on, no nothing, and we're gone for long hours, it's like almost guaranteed they're gonna fuck some shit up.
That's so cute.
Yeah.
What about you, Adam? Yeah. What did you guys get?
So Katrina and I normally, you know, we kind of go back and forth. Like some years, like if there's something like a bunch of stuff that I really want to get her, I'll just get her gifts. But normally, we actually agree that we actually get whatever it is together, and it's normally like a trip. So mm-hmm. we normally book. So we booked a ski in, ski out. Tahoe trip to Squaw Valley in February. And that's where, I don't know if you guys have ever been in a ski and ski out or not, but it's really cool. Where literally I can ski down from the slope, walk right up my steps into my little suite that I have there.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. So we can ride for a couple hours. Yeah,
super chill.
Hang out in the jacuzzi tub in our room and just kind of chill and have coffee and then go back out again. And so That's really cool. Yeah, it is really cool.
Yeah, no, we don't. Nice. We do the same thing. We don't get in each other really anything. We just talk about like doing something together.
Yeah.
I think that's more. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah. I also don't like the expecting of buying. I feel like it eliminates the magic, right?
Well, I feel like Katrina and I, for the most part, throughout the year, because I get her a lot of stuff throughout the year. I'm definitely the guy who shows up randomly and just a new outfit for her or flowers. Or so I buy a lot of stuff for her throughout the year just to show her that without expecting it, right? I'm anti-holiday guy. Like, if just because it's Valentine's Day, just because it's birthday, just because...
That's what I mean. It's the expectation of...
Yeah, I like to do things like that throughout the year. And for the most part, you know, her and I both, if there's things that we really want, we normally get it for ourselves or each other. And so when Christmas time comes around, there's this pressure of like, I got to think of something. It's like, well, why should we just try so hard to think of something to spend money on for you to buy? And let's do something we both have wanted to do for a while. And I'm like, hey, you know what? Last year I got her a snowboard. So this year I was like, well, let's book a trip where we can go ride and we can do all that.
So that's what Courtney did for me, which was cool. She booked us a trip to Seattle, I think probably around the same time.
Yeah, the girls were in cahoots on that.
So... Yeah, it'll be cool because my cousin's up there and like, you know, like I haven't really
hung out
there.
Is this the same weekend?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're going somewhere and you're going somewhere.
Yeah, I'm going to go to Seattle.
Oh, I guess I got
to
do something.
I already started to look because I've always wanted to like go to concerts or like, you know, see some bands and stuff up there and like, you know, hang out and like see Seattle and be there for more than like, you know, a couple hours. So
it's the first week. It's like the first weekend in February, right?
Yeah, something like that. I'll have Katrina send everything over to you so you have the dates and all that. Yeah, you guys should just come up where we're going. Go to Tahoe with us.
And do what?
Well, you don't have to snowboard. You can just hang out, you know? Yeah. Fuck, I might not be snowboarding. Who knows?
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Oh,
huh?
Dude.
Yeah.
How's your ankle doing there, buddy?
Yeah, how's your ankle, man?
MRI is tomorrow.
Did we tell the story yet on the podcast?
No. We haven't.
No.
People have seen you hobbling on the Insta story.
Yeah, what happened to your ankle, dude?
That's not a big deal. I saved this baby in traffic. You know, the car got my foot when I was...
The adrenaline kicked in. And
you had to kick the car over.
You know what? As much pain as I am right now, though, it's worth it. I mean, I feel like that kid will forever be grateful. And
probably be the next president.
Yeah. No, I tore my Achilles. I don't know how bad or what level yet. It's definitely bad. It's getting worse by the day, and we're already over a week with the injury. I went and saw Brink right afterwards, and he was like, yeah, it's torn. You're fucked. And I was like, well, I know it's still intact, though, because I can still move my foot and everything, so it's not...
Might be just a rupture.
Right.
You tore playing basketball.
Yeah, playing ball. And the shitty part, I really blame you. It's pretty much your fault.
I actually feel bad. You and all
your super nerd people that are fans of you on the show that didn't warn me. Like, you guys, you know what? You fuckers send me DMs like crazy, always telling me what to do. That why didn't someone give me a head up that low testosterone, there's a correlation with Achilles tears? Yeah. Like, I wish I would have known. I would have never been playing.
It's just one of those
good
things.
Looking out.
I'm in, like, my all-time low. I've been professing this on the show for, like, the last 2 months.
It's true. It's true that there is a strong correlation between low testosterone and tendon rupture, and I didn't
specifically even, Achilles.
I didn't even think of it. Like, I didn't think of it. It's something I read once a long time ago, so it was stored there.
Reminded when I did
and it just when you did it when you sent the text, then it like, you know, jarred my memory, and I was like, oh shit. So then I sent you that article, that study, and then you saw it. Well, whatever. Yeah. Sorry. Too late.
What a weird injury. Like, you know, I've had ACL, MCL. I've had level 3 ankle sprains a bajillion times through playing ball. First time ever injuring my Achilles, and it was a really weird thing. Like, and I'm on game 2 of playing. We won the first game. We're playing the second game. And having a great game. I'm playing good. I'm finally starting to catch my wind again. Rebound, score. Right after I scored, my guy starts taking off, obviously, down the court. I turn, take off to go with him, and all of a sudden I hear this loud pop, and it feels like someone took a baseball bat and just fucking cracked it across my calf, and hard enough to make me fall, you know? So I fall down, and I look back. I'm guarding this big, you know, they had me playing center at this game, so I'm guarding this big, huge Samoan guy, and I thought he's like stepped on it. As I was taking off, I thought he stepped on
it.
Was it
Isaac Sapwaka again?
No, but it was not quite that big. But the big dude liked that, right? So I look back and I'm angry. I'm like, what the fuck? Because it hurt right away, instantly hurt, and it made me fall. And I look back and he's like, he throws his hands up. He's like, dude, I was nowhere near you. Nobody was around me. And that's whenever in sports, like, you get an injury where no one is around you.
You know some shit will happen.
Yeah, it's normally something bad that happened, right? So I grab my ankle, my calf, and I'm like, oh, fuck, it hurts.
Did you cry?
I didn't cry.
Okay, good.
But I went to get up, and
it's okay if you did.
Yeah, you can cry though. Yeah.
No, I didn't. It was close to that kind of pain by the time I got home. Like, it obviously continued to get worse and worse and worse. When I first got up, I went to put weight on it, and it felt like my foot just went through the court. Like, there was nothing stopping my foot from going through the court. It felt really weird. And that was when it just kind of confirmed for me, like, oh, this isn't good at all. Mm. And then I sat.
It's not a complete tear.
No, it's not completely, or else it would have wrapped up in my calf. Yeah. I would have seen it, right? But sometimes those are the worst, dude. Like when I tore my MCL, I completely exploded. I fucking blew it completely. And it actually wasn't that bad. Like I was, after I was injured, I was in basketball also. And I'm like walking up down the court. I'm like, I think I'm going to go back in. But it felt weird because like something was missing. Yeah. And so I was like, okay, I probably shouldn't. And then find out that I tore my MCL and my ACL. Well, when this happened, there was no like, put me back in, coach. It was like the pain was like intensifying by the minute. And I was like, oh God, this is getting worse. I remember just wincing how bad it was. Got home, put it up, iced it, whatever. And then next day went and saw Brink. And then Brink did the little confirmation on me like, yeah, dude, you're fucked.
Shit.
Yeah. So.
Well, Godspeed, man.
Yeah, no, it'll be, we'll figure out some content out of this. So, you know, people, I'm sure I'm not the first one to fuck their Achilles or ankle so they can rehab. I'm going to rehab myself. I'm not doing any fucking physical therapy or any bullshit like that. So I'll share my journey as I go through that. I just wish I would have known that about low testosterone and Achilles because I'm just an asshole asking for it by doing that. I mean, if you're low, I'm
the one sport that stresses the Achilles.
Right,
more
right. It definitely is up there with the top sports that probably stress the Achilles more than anything else. And then being at the lowest in my life of testosterone, it's just a recipe for disaster. Mm-hmm. If I would have even known that, I wouldn't have been doing that too. So
well, now you're forced, right?
Right, right. So we'll do the whole rehab process. So make sure to try and document, share that with people, what that looks like for me. As of right now, it's a lot of just icing and elevating. Yesterday.
Having me and Justin get things for you.
I hate that, too. Let me tell you, dude.
Take advantage, dude. We will help you.
Don't encourage him, Sal.
We will help you. Yeah. Unless you want something we don't think you should have. You know what I mean?
We'll give him a little bell.
He's like, Sal, give me that Diet Coke over there. And I come back and it's kombucha. He's like, I don't want a fucking Diet Coke. I'm like, listen, buddy.
That's not what I wanted.
I'm the middleman now.
Oh shit.
Dude, I didn't tell you guys. So
I'll give you piggyback rides.
So for Christmas morning, I forgot to talk about this to you guys. Pretty crazy. So me and my ex-wife have dual custody of the kids. So every year we alternate who has the kids for Christmas. So this year was my year, and my ex was having a tough time. First off, she lost her mom years ago, not that long ago, which is tough on the holidays. Now she doesn't have the kids. Her aunt moved away, so she's got no one kind of around.
Oh, wow.
And, dude, my girl invited her.
Oh, shit. How did that go?
You know what?
Did she say yes?
She did, and it went very well.
Wow.
Because she was grateful that she could come and watch be there for my kids when my kids come downstairs.
That's awesome, bro, because that's the first step of like, if this is going to work and things are, she's going to have
it. Will. Everybody's mature.
That's
about
how Katrina's family, it's the funniest thing ever, or at least it was funny for me because my family's the opposite. My family is, once we don't like somebody, we just stop speaking to them. Everyone divides from each other. It's awkward as fuck.
It's not good for the kids, dude.
No, of course not.
No, and so she was there and we're all eating breakfast and hanging out. My kids see everybody's cool. And it was a very it was an amazing Christmas because of that, to see that, you know, to see that we can all
now what was
be
I
okay
now yeah. Was that weird? That's for awesome, you at man. All though, first time of doing that, kind of like having the wife and the ex-wife and the girlfriend in that living room? I mean, that's kind of the first time you did something like that where you guys are doing like a real family.
No, because nobody made it that way. You know what I mean? Nobody made it weird. Everybody acted, you know, cool. Everybody was friendly. She brought mimosas, you know, and then my girlfriend made coffee and we're enjoying her coffee.
Did she have her boyfriend with her or no?
No. No. Oh, so I would have liked that even more.
No, that would have been even better.
Because I would have loved to see her boyfriend doesn't live here. Her boyfriend lives in another state. But
he
I would
come around for the holidays?
No, she's actually over there now with the kids.
Got it.
But I would have loved for the kids to see everybody. Because I feel like, and I'm not an expert on this, but I feel like the biggest challenge when it comes to divorce with kids, I feel like there's two of them. One is that the kids feel like, you know, maybe one of their parents or both of their parents aren't there for them like they used to be, or they lose a little bit of stability. And it's typically one, right? Or I guess on average, it tends to be the man, where the dad kind of now all of a sudden becomes a weekend dad. So you don't see them like you used to. So for a kid, they lose that stability, which I'm very involved with my kids, so they don't have that. But then the other part of it, I think, is when they see that their parents, you know, all of a sudden, you know, they hated each other before. Now they really hate each other, and they've got this divide or these two lives.
Forces them to kind of choose.
Yeah, or feel like it a little bit. Because remember, your kids are always going to identify with their parents because they're your parents. Even if one of them's shitty or whatever, they're going to identify with them. And so, you know, my kids seeing that all these adults in their life are working together to raise them, I think it's a good thing. I think it's a very good
thing. No, I think it's
extreme. And the kids had a great time.
Wow.
You
that's
know?
Great, man.
I was really, it's probably.
Well, it's a win all the way around for them. It's like if you guys all get together and get along and you guys get, that's more gifts for them. That's a fucking win, dude.
The respect that I have for my girlfriend went, I mean, just in the, I already respected the hell out of her, but to be able to invite, you know, your boyfriend's ex-wife to your house for your Christmas.
Well, it was clutch that she did it too.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's one thing if you do that and you're kind of like not really sure on like how she feels about it, or but the fact that it was her idea and she did it means everything, man.
Yeah, because she wasn't going to come. She wasn't going to come. And she did. It was really nice. It was really cool. Kids enjoyed it. We enjoyed it. So cool stuff.
That is cool.
Very cool.
Doug, could you bring on the sensitive bird, please?
Yeah.
The bird's been sensitive a lot lately.
I know. What a wuss. We're going to fucking come the new year, bro. We're rocking this shit up right now.
He's got to get some testosterone in him.
That's what it's. It's my fault. It's my fault.
Come on, bird. something crazier. Yeah.
Bring on the motherfucking quaw.
This quaw is brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
First question is from Abron89. You talk about eating healthy and intuitively quite often, and how we should avoid processed foods. Can you provide advice to those of us whose palates don't like all the healthy food options you rave about?
You know what? You can. So I like this question because people assume that they have a fixed mindset mentality when it comes to the foods that they enjoy.
Right. That it can't change.
Yeah, like people will say, no, I don't like that. Or I do like that, as if it's a fixed.
It's always going to be that way.
Yeah. Think about all the foods you liked as a kid that you don't like as an adult, and think of all the foods that you hated as a kid that you now like. I can pretty much guarantee you.
Dude, it's completely changed for me.
Dude, I can guarantee you, you won't find a single child, or maybe rare, that a kid likes black coffee. Or that a kid likes, you know, olives or blue cheese or, you know, spicy foods.
Beer.
Or beer. Yeah. But then as an adult, you develop a palate for enjoying these foods. The processed food market or the food manufacturers know how to get you to change associations with foods so that you did start to develop a palate for them through those associations. So when you watch food commercials, you see, you know, people having fun if they're eating a particular food, or when you go to the movies, you have popcorn, so you tend to crave popcorn, or why do we want birthday cake at birthday parties and kind of no other time really think about, you know, birthday cake and those types of things. A lot of those are associations we've created, and so we actually change our palate. Our palate isn't just affected by taste. It's also affected by texture, color, context, smell, our moods, and our associations with those foods. So you can change your palate quite a bit through understanding these processes and through manipulating them. And we've all experienced this, you know, ourselves.
Yeah, I think it's important, though, to note that it's a process. Like, it's not...
Yeah, totally.
It's not like this, hey, try this, see if you like it, and, you know, oh, you don't like it, oh, you know, force it down your throat, and then eventually you will like it. It's like, you know, so I something that I just... We went to Katrina's family for Christmas. And of course, there's, you know, desserts galore everywhere, from cookies and pies and stuff. I now, which is completely different, just maybe 5 years ago or a little more than that, would not be like this. I gravitate towards the things that are really light and not sweet, or that were actually cooked. Like Katrina made these cookies without flour, and they're on the healthier side of cookies. I mean, I don't think there's really healthy cookies, but a better choice. And I actually enjoy those now. Now, if you would ask me that 10 years ago, I would think they taste bland and not sweet enough or whatever, because I'm so accustomed to this overload of sugar that we have packed in all of our food. And so it's taken me years to change my palate by eliminating a lot of those foods in my diet. Now, when I want things like that, I actually crave some of the healthier stuff. So, but that took years.
Yeah.
It took years of, you know, winging myself off of things that I probably shouldn't be consuming on a regular basis, introducing foods that were healthier choices, and playing with the recipes too to find things that kind of that make me enjoy it a little bit more and a little bit more.
Yeah, and I think for me, you know, just changing and reframing a lot of my thought process around foods, like just having more of an open mind and I like texture used to be a big flag for me. Like if something had a weird texture or whatever, or even looked funky, like there was no way I'm eating that shit, you know? And that was like, again, that's me saying that out loud. And like in my head, I'm like, no way I'm eating that shit. And then just over the years, I've just been more like, well, you know, I've been surprised before and, you know, I'll give it a shot. And I just over and over repetition wise of me like trying to check myself on that, like trigger in my head, like, no, like, you know, this weird feeling, like it all starts there. Like for me. So once I started to do that, then I'm at a restaurant and I'm eating like eggplant, or I'm eating like, you know, some kind of a fish that I would never eat before, or like, you know, Brussels sprouts, or like just because of the way that, you know, they prepared it. I was like, wow, that I didn't expect that. You know,
this is, by the way, this isn't like a theory. This is 100% science. You create associations with foods, your palate changes. Look, I'll give you an example right now. Everybody can relate to. Think of a food that you used to like to eat that got you really, really sick one time. You probably don't like it anymore.
Yeah.
Your brain immediately creates an association when you get really, really sick off of something. Like I used to love, when I was a kid, I used to love chili with a lot of cheese in it. And one day I ate chili with cheese in it and I ate a lot of it and I got really sick and I threw up. And until that happened, now if I smell chili with a lot of cheese in it, it makes me want to vomit. That's an association. It's a very strong one, but we can all relate to it. So there's some of your evidence right there. So here's some tips you can do for yourself that will help you make better associations with food. First and foremost, a tool you can use to resensitize yourself to taste or to clean the palate, if you will. I know that term's used all the time when with eating, but this does help. It's fasting. Fasting is a great way to start the process. I would say start with a 24 to 48 hour fast if you're trying to do this fast track way.
As long as you're healthy and everything.
As long as you're healthy. When you go to reintroduce yourself to foods, reintroduce yourself to healthy foods, and you'll find that things like fruit and vegetables will actually start to taste better to you. So that's one thing you could do. The second thing you could do is start to make positive associations with healthy foods and make negative associations with unhealthy foods. And the only way you can do that is by becoming aware of the way these foods affect you, becoming aware of the reactions you have with these foods. So if I have, let's say I'm really, really enjoy eating bread, but I want to start to kind of eliminate that from my diet, I need to start making negative associations with bread. So once I eat the bread, I notice I get a little bloated. I start to get fatigued.
Just watch What's with Grains.
Yeah, it doesn't make me feel good. You know, I start to learn more about it. When I eat this bread, I pay attention to those things. Like, man, I feel so bloated. Start making those associations and you'll find that you'll start craving less and less.
Right.
With the positive, start creating the positive associations with the good foods. So I'm eating these vegetables, I'm eating these fruits, I'm eating these lean meats or whatever. I notice when I eat this way, I feel really good. And remind yourself of how you feel. Remind yourself of your digestion. Why is my digestion so good? Oh, I ate that spinach earlier, or I ate that broccoli earlier, or I notice my energy doesn't dip so quickly after I ate that steak and vegetables, or whatever it is that you're noticing these positive associations from. And if you continue to remind yourself of these things, little by little, you'll start to find that you'll want the things that you have created positive associations with, and you'll start to not want the things you have negative associations with. This is very, very powerful because most of us are so unaware of these associations when we eat foods, unless it's a strong association like, you know, getting sick, like the one I said earlier, that the only association that we connect to food is taste. So we go through our lives and all we associate with food is how good it tastes, in which case we've only created positive associations with these bad foods. Of course, if you eat a cupcake and all you think about is the taste, all you're thinking about is this great like flavor that I get from this cupcake. So I only have this positive association.
And all these foods that are processed are one-upping each other. It's like
they're designed to hammer that.
Yeah, when you look at the most popular ice cream cupcake stores and all this shit like that, it's like so much fucking sugar and stuff that they're packing in there. And that reason why people love it, it's because it's like a new level. It's like, oh, I was just eating these plain old cookies before, but man, if you haven't had those Mothers, those things are fucking next level. And it's just all they're doing is they're pumping more and more sugar in there. And it's just, it's like, and that's what when we reference it like a drug. And once you kind of recognize it as that, then you can start to kind of unpack it and then look for ways. And I think, Sal, you're right with connecting. Now, it also helps, too, to know the way someone's eating is how – this is a tough question because, you know, I have clients that struggle with not eating vegetables. I have clients that struggle with – and I keep referencing sugar, like they eat tons of sugar. You know, I have clients that just don't get enough healthy fat. So it really depends – where you're lacking and then food addictions that you have on how I advise you to eventually move this into eating. But I think what Sal was saying is a great...
And there's a mentality that's around it too. I've been there. Look, I've had a plate of food that I thought I was supposed to eat that was quote unquote healthy. And I sit down in front of this food and my whole motivation, my whole desire to eat this food is I know I'm trying to get lean or I'm trying to build muscle. So I'm not even allowing myself the space to learn how to enjoy these foods.
Right, right.
It's all about, oh, I got to eat my cup of broccoli, you know, cram it down my mouth. I did it because I have so much discipline. I was, you know, fucking dogged about it. I was dogmatic about it. But at some point, you're going to end up, you know, falling off the wagon or whatever. And I did. I would go through periods of eating what I was supposed to through pure discipline and determination. And then I go off of it versus... looking at these foods that you think are healthy, going into it and giving yourself the space to try to enjoy them. So now I'm eating this food and instead of saying I have to eat this, I'm saying I'm choosing to eat this because it's good for me. Let me like focus on the taste of it and see what I can get out of this, what I can pull out of it. So I did this recently with wine. I never liked the taste of wine. Just didn't enjoy it. Didn't know why people enjoyed it. And my girlfriend told me, hey, why don't you apply what you do with food to see if you can start to give yourself space? Because I hadn't realized, but I had decided I just didn't like wine. Like I'd made up my decision, fixed mindset, not going to like it. And she said, you know, why don't you drink it and apply what you've said with food and try and provide yourself some space to see if you can enjoy it, you know, go open-minded. And so I did. And I started sipping on it and I started breaking down the taste and little at a time, by the way, because if I had too much, it would have been overwhelming. And I actually, believe it or not, started enjoying wine a little bit. You can do this with food. It's fucking a trip, but it's not this new breakthrough thing that I invented. Like I said, food, you know, advertisers have known this for decades. They just do this for you. You don't even realize it. Every commercial, every time you see a store or you look at the box of cereal, the way they present it, how the grocery store puts things together, they're doing that for you. It's all part of the process. If you unpack it and do it for yourself, you may find yourself in a position where, I'll tell you what, I never have to tell somebody to eat healthy if they enjoy the food that they're eating and it's healthy. Right. You're no longer dieting or whatever. You just enjoy doing it.
It takes a while to get there, though.
It does
take a while. And I think the first step is just becoming aware. That's why I said, you know, knowing what this person is already addicted to or what they lack. Like that helps, too. And that's the first step for you. So before you worry about, you know, oh, what? How do I find a way to like these foods? It's like, well, first you need to become aware of like, what are you probably over consuming? Because I'm pretty sure you're like everybody else, which we know we all have these tendencies of that we lean towards of foods that aren't great choices that you're probably over consuming. And then where are you lacking?
So I heard about these new, I don't know anything about, other than what I was talking about with a friend of mine. So I don't know what the names of these diets are or whatever, but there are these diets now that are coming out that are focused on the palate. And what I mean by that is they encourage people to eat. They're not allowed to use seasoning. They're not allowed to dress up food. They have to eat very bland. But they're also told that they can eat as much as they want. Now, we know that if you do that, you're not going to eat that much because you start to get palate fatigue. Chris Kresser talked about this on our podcast.
Right.
I think that's a very smart approach because it could change your palate to the point where you do. Then when you go and you start to season healthy food, now it's like, oh shit, this is so good just right. because I put a little basic seasoning on it.
Right, right.
You know, kind of interesting stuff to think
well,
about.
Well, I went through that when I was competing because when you're competing at one point, you eventually take out everything and you're eating boiled fucking chicken and weird shit like that. And it's like once I came out of that, my palate was reset on another level I had never experienced in my 36 years of my life. Like, literally, I'll never forget biting into that first apple after I'd done that, and an apple had never tasted like that before. My entire life, an apple is just kind of like, whatever, you know, even the best apples that everyone would rave about. It's like, for me, it doesn't really, because I was so over consuming sugar for so long. It wasn't until I pulled all that shit out and then cleaned my palate out. Then I went out, tried an apple, felt like I was biting into candy, dude. It was crazy.
Next up is RC Day. Adam mentioned some of his goals for 2018 on a recent episode. What are the New Year's goals for the rest of the boys?
Fuck, mine might be changing.
Yeah, well, yours was what, basketball?
Basketball and snowboarding was part of that. You know, fucking that really, that's a rough one for me too. That's why this was like this injury was a very depressing one, because I had already kind of set my 2018, like these were two things that are important to me, which, don't get me wrong, they're still there. Like, that's so the goal is to rehab and be back to my normal self. Like, but it's going to be a fucking process now, where it was like I was already on my way. So that's a little bummer for me.
How about you, Justin? Do you have any goals?
Yeah, mainly musically driven. So, I mean, I kind of started that with like getting an amp again, an electric guitar, and starting to read music again. On the piano, I'll go over to my parents' house every now and then, play the piano with my mom, and just like getting in that mindset for me has been really fun, and it's something that I've always enjoyed. And it's a different operating system, you know, like your brain. It's just interesting to me that like I start to think differently, and I start to see things a little bit differently. And I don't know, man, I have a problem. Like, if you guys are doing something, I want to do something a little bit different. And so this is like one of my things, like. I want to get a little more artistic and express that a little bit more in that direction going into next year. And then as far as fitness is concerned, just really more health-driven fitness goals for me. So I really want to tackle this. And I've put somewhat of a dent as far as a formula to help really tackle this, like acid reflux, and get this under control. And even watching the What's the Grains.
Oh, What's with Wheat?
Or What's with Wheat? Is that what it was? Oh, yeah.
Have you guys avoided it since then? Or I know you had the holidays probably.
Yeah. So, like, yeah, we were like all on this kick to do that. And then, like, we had to, like, check ourselves, be like, okay, you know, let's be slow. Yeah. You know, like, let's do this right. And so, but yeah, that, because, I mean, there was a little excerpt in there from, I think it was Mark Sisson. He was talking about, like, the correlation there, you know, even with acid reflux and greens. And so, I mean, I just really want to like get myself super healthy, because that's affected acid erosion in my teeth, like grinding, like my teeth have been fucked up. And I have like a plan for that, to fix my teeth. I got a guy that said he's willing to help me with that. So, yeah, man, I mean, it's really like longevity based goals for me for next year, and just like really trying to get into my optimal state of health, and then like get back into pouring into pressing, you know, my fitness and moving on that a little harder. So
awesome. You know, so I didn't think I had a goal, but now that we're talking about it, I guess I do. Cause I talked to you guys about this through text on, I want to say on Christmas or Christmas Eve. And this is kind of a mind pump goal, but I'm making one, this a personal one as well, is I'm really going to try, cause now we have a platform. We have a podcast that reaches, you know, millions of people or whatever. I really want to reach out, you know, more so, and we kind of started doing this at the end of this year, to non-fitness individuals and people that, you know, are in areas that we are passionate about ourselves. And I've already done that. I've already contacted a few people, and there are areas of science that I'm very passionate about. There's areas of political commentary and economics that I'm very passionate about, you know, current events. And I'm going to make it a goal now in 2018 to reach out to people who I think are interesting and fascinating, that I think our audience will appreciate. Part of it's for selfish reasons. I myself There's people that I've always wanted to meet and talk to, mm-hmm. and now I can say, hey, I have a podcast. You know, that reaches all these people. You want to come on my show?
Yeah.
But I want to reach out to people that have nothing to do with fitness and just have incredible conversations with them and build relationships with them and just see what happens. You know, I don't know how we're going to, you know, position it, if we position it as like bonus episodes or whatever, but I think it would be really cool because I know the three of us have very different interests.
Yeah.
And I think it would be really cool to, you know, to meet and talk to people in different, because it's just, there's a lot of fascinating stuff out there. It doesn't have to get too deep, but mm-hmm. there's a lot of fascinating stuff out there. And I grow, I've noticed so much growth just from meeting people in our space through the podcast. And I can't imagine what that's going to look like when I now feel like I can reach out. Well, side of fitness.
You know what's awesome about that is not only do you grow, but our audience grows as well, because now everybody needs to be challenged as far as their thought process. And, you know, I love that. I love that idea and that mentality and like bringing entrepreneurs in for me, like business wise, that I'm interested in that are doing something completely different than us, but we could all learn from these people and their experiences. So, I'm all for that, man. That'd be awesome.
Yeah, because I'm looking, initially, I'm probably going to try to talk to people that I like, but then I think I'm going to reach out to people that I don't,
yeah.
you know, that I disagree with. Right. Now I'm not going to bring somebody on who's, or at least I hope not, going to bring someone on as an asshole, but I want to bring people on too that I completely disagree with and have discussions with on the podcast. Right. I think it would be a great challenge for us as hosts and for the audience as well.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it'll be a lot of fun.
No, you know where I stand on that. I think I'm excited. I've been wanting us to do that for a while. We're so different. As much as we are similar in fitness, there's so many other topics that each of us are going home and reading and studying or into or geeking out on. It's like, mm-hmm. I think it's slowly introducing some of that into the show, I think it's a good thing. I think it's a healthy thing. And you know, I think one day the show will be more segmented where, you know, like on Tuesdays you get this type of information, Wednesdays you get kind of this. And I think this is the first step in that direction, is starting to involve guests that aren't completely related to just health and fitness. So I think there's so much more to having a healthy life than just working out and macros.
Yeah. Thank you.
You know, there's your mental health and understanding the world that we live in, and there's other topics that feed the soul, man. And that's, I think, so important for you to be a well-rounded, healthy individual. And just talking about the right way to lift weights and eat food all the time, like, I'll go fucking insane if that was what our show was forever. like that's yeah, not the project.
Not redundant at all.
No, yeah. It's not the project that I'm... I mean, I remember how much it was, but it was good. That was good for me to see... When we first started, like this, you know, this bodybuilder guy, like I was so the bodybuilder guy, the bro on the show, and had to be that person when we first started. And it is what it is. But it reminded me so much of like, no, it's not. I don't identify with that. I don't want to just only talk about that and do that. That's an aspect that's a part of my life, and I'm very proud of it. And it was a fun time, and I have a lot to say about it. But I have a lot to say about a bunch of shit. you know yeah. what I'm saying? So. It's exciting to see us do that. I'm going to continue to go the direction with the rehab on my foot and still get myself back, because getting back to what we're saying right here is about the being healthy. There's other aspects of life that will contribute to that. You know, snowboarding and basketball are two things that, one, feed my soul and make me very happy. I mean, nothing reminds me of being in flow state more than when I'm flying down a mountain or when I'm playing basketball. And I don't need to be at any extreme levels. I mean, I was a really good snowboarder and I was really good at basketball, but I don't need to be playing at that level to still get the health benefits. Mm-hmm. And so I'm going to continue to pursue that and get in that kind of shape, because those things. And I also, that's what connects me to my childhood friends who are like family to me. So as we've gotten older and people have gotten married and got their houses in different towns, we've grown apart from each other. And I recognize what a better human I am when I make sure that I stay connected to those that love me and that have been with me for a very long time. And easily we've all become very disconnected from that. And there's a few things that draw us all together, and snowboarding and ball and things like that, sports. It sounds silly, but I've made an effort, and I will make an effort this year of, you know, getting back to like watching basketball and football on a pretty regular basis.
Oh, it's play for you, dude. We don't play enough.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, all of a sudden exercise became like work.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like how totally. Many kids play?
Right.
They don't go work out, you know? And I mean, lifting weights for me is play. It really is. I really enjoy doing it.
Yeah.
But if you like doing something else, you know, this goes for you. If you're listening right now, we talk all the time about ideal workout programs and programming and all this, that, and the other. But at the end of the day, it ain't going to do shit for you if you hate it and you don't do it. If you enjoy doing something else and you're moving and you're playing, like, just do that.
Well, I think,
you know what I'm saying?
I think everybody at one point should go through some sort of a structure to learn, like to get the understanding of like what good biomechanics looks like, what a good program looks like, how you should be eating for yourself and becoming in tune with that. But once you get there, I mean, the ultimate evolution is intuitive eating and intuitive training. You understand what is best for your body, how you should be eating, how you should be working out and training, and then you incorporate the things that you love and you're passionate about. And that goes for both the eating side of it and the exercise part of it.
Absolutely. And, you know, if we understand that the mind and your emotions and your body, it's all the same, it's all one, then you understand that going to the gym and working out your body, which is good for the body, but sitting there and fucking hating it with your mind and your emotions makes that way less better for you.
Right.
It just does. So I'm in the gym and I'm fucking hating what I'm doing, even though it's good for my body, it's not really good
right.
for me. Versus,
and it's short-lived.
Versus I go, you know, hiking or I go play basketball or I go swimming and it's good for my body. Maybe not as good as structured exercise, but it's still good for my body, but it's also good for my mind and my emotional state. Well, now it's really fucking good for me. So keep that in mind. Like if you go and you work out and you're hating every second of your workout, you are actually not doing something that's really super good for you or as good as it could be for you because you're doing something. How good could it be for you if you're in it and you're fucking hating it the whole time?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So and that doesn't mean it doesn't need to be tough because there are plenty of things that you do that are challenging that you also enjoy. You know, playing basketball and snowboarding, it ain't easy. I'm sure you're breathing hard. I'm sure you're challenging yourself, but you're loving it the entire
right.
time.
Right.
So it makes a massive, massive difference. And it's a very important message to communicate to people because we get so stuck in on the, you know, exercise sucks mentality and I'm grinding and this, that, and the other where you're missing out on the benefits. You're missing out on the benefits of enjoying what you're doing. And that's a lot. There's a lot of benefit there.
Right.
Next question is from Mikey V Fitness. Gary V preaches about eating shit for 2 years before you hit success. As a young trainer, do I go full on with this approach and sacrifice some of my health, or do I stick to trying to maintain healthy and practice what I preach for the longer run Ooh. To success?
You know what I don't like about his message sometimes, which is a common one?
I know you're not a big fan of Gary.
Well, here's why I'm a big fan of him. I'm a big fan of the way he communicates. I think he's a very effective communicator. I think he's a very intelligent guy. You know, where he came from, you know, obviously he's the son of immigrants. And so I respect the hell out of him. His message is a very common one you see with
motivators,
these motivational speakers.
Yeah.
And it's a glamorous one. And what I mean by that is if you see someone that is successful and doing very well, and when you talk to them, they tell you about how awesome it is, how easy it's been for them. It's flowed this entire time. And yeah, I work long, but I enjoy what I do and I'm having a lot of fun. You kind of don't like that. Like, I want to hear about how bad it sucks for you and the grind that you put it through. And I want to hear all that shit because that makes it better. It sounds better to me. You know what I'm saying? Like, nobody wants to see somebody that's ripped, muscular, fit, and wants to hear them talk about how it's easy for them because they enjoy the process. They want to hear about how shitty it is and how much it sucks. And there's a little bit of, our egos in particular like pain. We like to identify with pain. We like to identify with something that sucks. Now, that doesn't mean that you don't have to, that there are sacrifices that are made when you're pushing yourself in an extreme level. Like if you're trying to get a 6-year degree in 4 years, you're going to have to sacrifice time. You're going to put a lot more effort and you know, work into it. But this mentality, this martyrship mentality where in order for you to be successful at something, you have to fucking hate your life. I don't buy that. I think it happens sometimes, but I don't buy that. I don't think that's necessary. I think it's just a common, popular thing to sell. Mm. And you see this with a lot of these, you know.
I'm going to take the I'm going to take the defending Gary V here, because there is some truth, in my opinion, to, you know, when you first start off having this attitude that I'm going to eat shit for 2 years and I'm okay with that. Like, I'm okay with knowing that I'm just getting started on this venture, or, I mean, just, I had that mentality when we started this one. Mind you, love what I do. The process has been amazing, this and that. But in my head, I told myself that I'm not going to see any return. I'm going to be on this Instagram posting things 4 times a day, every single day, hoping to God that it takes off and explodes, but knowing damn well it probably won't. And I will have to outgrind it. I will have to grind for some time before I see any momentum. So there is some truth to me to say that, you know, when you first start a new venture, no matter what that venture is, that you're going to eat shit. Now, I don't think it needs to be an either or. I don't think it needs to be this, you know, should I listen to Gary V and eat shit for 2 years, let myself go and just be so and grind and not be healthy and live your brand. Let me tell you, I started off as a trainer and I still live my brand, but I fucking worked 7 days a week and ate shit for a year, but I still worked out too. That was still part of that process of eating shit, of I'm getting up early to train or doing what I need to do to stay fit, to represent my brand, myself as a trainer, being fit, meanwhile, while I'm trying to grow and build this business. So, you know, to me, I think there's, and I think that message, right, why Gary V, I think, is exploding is it resonates with so many the younger generation coming up. I hate to say millennials because we always pick on them, but it's true. A lot, there's this entitlement thing that we have right now in the last 10, 15 years where people think that, oh, just because I went to school or did this, that I should all of a sudden fall into that. And I think that's a lot of his message is like, listen, kid, you're only 25, you're only 26, you're going to fucking eat shit for a while, you're going to work hard. That's all part of the learning and growing curve and mm-hmm. process. And so I do believe there's a little truth to this. I also agree with Sal that I know some of these guys, you know, glorify the grind a little more than what reality is. And we don't talk about, like, you don't hear him sharing like his relationship with his spouse or his kids or his family, like what, how much that's probably suffered. And, you know, does everybody in his family and his friends immediately like those people really love him? And does he get quality time with those people? Like, we don't know that. I don't know that for sure. I could speculate what I think on somebody who's, yeah.
You know what it is? It's the, okay. So we've all been there and grinded before. We've all grinded very hard, mm-hmm. but I've always loved it.
Right.
Do you see what I'm saying?
I mean, that was the point I was thinking the whole time. It's like, for me, it's always been about if this is something that I'm super passionate about and I am in love with where this direction is going and what I know the potential for it is so great, like I'm willing to do more and put more in. And that just requires more grinding to get it up and running. And that's just part of the process. I don't look at that as a martyrdom of like, ah, oh, fuck, I have to do it. Like, I enjoy, you know, putting my time in. And then when I realize it's just punishment, right? Like, that I've been in situations like that where like I will do this and I'm just basically punishing myself for a couple of years.
Yeah, that's the thing.
And then you're just like, I got to get away from this. This is not a fucking healthy thing for me.
That's
like, even if it does pay off, mm-hmm. it's going to destroy me. And so being able to kind of discern at the beginning whether or not this is, you know, the one that you're ultimately passionate about and you see it flourishing as far as like some, you're, you know, you being like excited and being in a healthy mindset, but you know it's going to take a lot of work versus like, no, I'm just doing this because I have to and it's what I have to fucking do.
Yeah, it's like someone saying like, you know, we use fitness because obviously we talk a lot about fitness. You know, you have to grind and work hard and there's got to be a lot of pain and sweat in order to be fit. So now you've got someone who's working out. They're doing everything wrong. They don't know it, but they think they're doing everything right, but they're doing everything wrong. But they've identified with the pain and the sweat and the fucking everything has to suck first part. So they just keep doing the same shit. They just keep going in there, sweating their ass off, working hard, getting very little return. But because they think that that's what it takes, that they've identified with the hard part,
right?
That now they're not able to be objective. They're not able to step out and say, well, this sucks, and I hate it.
Well, then they're attracting. Then they're just attracting the shit, right? if you identify with it, and it's, I just don't. I think that's a very valid point to make. That, you know, there are people that that see messages like that, and then they're like seeking out like being miserable, and then it turns into this competition, like who's suffering the most. Like we see that in competing and stuff like that. And it's like, well, no, there's a smart approach. It's not just about suffering. So and, I'm on both sides of this, right? So I think
Gary Vee loves the grind. I don't think for a second he's doing what he's doing. He's thinking, this fucking sucks. I hate this. I think he fucking loves it. Mm-hmm. So he preaches it, but he doesn't realize that he fucking loves it. You know, I've met lots of very successful people who bust their ass and they love it.
He talks about that. Mm-hmm. And I think he talks a lot about that, like that he loves what he's doing. He doesn't pose himself as a martyr or that it just is rough and whatever. I think that he knows who he's speaking to. He's speaking to this younger generation that, in my opinion, needs to hear that shit. Mm-hmm. I think the more people that have worked for me that are in their early 20s need to hear this message that, listen, dude, you are going to eat shit for a while. You are going to grind for a while. It is going to be tough. You are going to have to go the extra mile to try and stay fit and be successful at the same time right now. That's the part of the eating shit. It's not eat shit and so you're going to sacrifice, you know, being in shape or things like that. It's like, no, that's part of what eating shit means that you are going to have to work harder than the guy or the girl next to you who's been doing this for 15, 20 years that gets the easy leads, that everybody knows who they are already. Everyone's given them a leg up because they've proven themselves. You got to prove yourself right now. You got to prove, and not to anybody else but yourself. You got to prove that you have what it takes to get up early when it's hard to get up or work that extra day when you'd rather be off hanging out with your friends. That's the eating shit for 2 years. That's the part but that...
There's another side to this too. He's talking about being healthy and fit. You know, fitness will make you more successful at your business
right.
also. Mm-hmm. So yeah, you're not going to be like training hardcore and being a competitive athlete. But if you have a mentality where you're like, okay, I need to work hard at my job or my business, therefore I'm doing no fitness and I'm eating crappy, you're going to actually...
That's lazy, dude. That's a poor excuse.
And not only is it a poor excuse, but it's going to make you less effective.
Right, yeah. Exactly.
So,
I mean, the fact that that's even in this question right now, that's a flag right away that, dude, you know...
I think it's an excuse. I've met so many people who were successful in business and then really overweight and unhealthy, and they'll tell me, oh, you know what? I've been so focused on my business that I don't have time to be fit and eat right. And I just want to tell them, listen, you do realize that you'd be more effective
right.
at business. You got successful in spite of your bad health.
I know all the motherfuckers are doing it because I do it still. Yeah. I still catch myself playing that same mental game with myself, justifying why I didn't make it to the gym, why I didn't eat, why I didn't do these things because I'm so fucking busy. So I know because I fucking do it too. But it's okay. It's just know that you're using that as an out. It's like you're using that as an excuse. Like, no, how about you be healthy, practice what you preach, train, and fucking eat shit for 2 years. That's part of this. You're going to be working your ass off for quite some time before you really, you know, reap what you sow.
Funny, man. You never have to tell somebody to work hard when they're doing what they love.
Right.
And they have passion behind it. You never. Yeah. In fact, somebody's really passionate about something. I've seen for myself in particular the opposite, where I have to tell myself to take a step back.
Right.
Because I'm so passionate about this thing that I'm doing. That's all I want to do.
Right, right. No, that's another thing too. If you really feel like, you know, again, the eating shit thing is an analogy, I believe. But if you really feel like the whole process is miserable and it's really tough for you, then it's probably not the right thing for you. You know, it should feel maybe tough because it's a lot you're trying to accomplish. You're making big sacrifices because 2 years before this, you were hanging out with your buddies on the week. I remember this. I remember this transition of, you know, and there's nothing worse than having to hear your friends and everyone around you be like, oh, you never come out anymore. You never go drinking with us, or, you know, you never come play video games for fucking a whole Saturday. Like, you don't do that stuff anymore. And you're like, yeah, my priorities have changed. There's things that are more important to me than getting that. That's not to say that I won't revisit that or I won't find balance with that in my life. But right now I'm career driven. And so I'm going to eat shit for a while and I'm going to do what it takes to succeed. And so I think you got to have that mentality and you got to recognize if you're actually enjoying the process or not.
Next question is from S. Caddy. I see Navy SEALs and other military professionals that are jacked and able to run or swim sustained for long distances. I refuse to believe that, like many bro scientists claim, if you train cardio, you always lose all your gains. If you were training cardiovascular endurance and you didn't want to lose muscle mass, how would you do that? Is there a way to use nutrition to stave off or completely eliminate the loss of muscle when training cardio?
So this person made a cardinal mistake with their observations that a lot of us make.
Right, right.
So this is the equivalent of me
comparing an athlete, dude.
Yeah. So if I see a pro, if I didn't know any better, and I went to the NBA and I watched all these guys play basketball, I could make the false assumption that basketball makes you really fucking tall. Like, geez, man, if you play a lot of basketball,
well, that jumping,
you're gonna get really tall. So he's making the false assumption that because he sees these high level Navy SEALs and military professionals that are muscular, who are doing all this cardio, that, you know, wow, it not only does it not make you lose muscle, but if you do a lot of it, you'll build muscle like they will. Well, that's not true at all. What you're seeing are genetically gifted individuals who were able to be muscular in spite of the fact that they're doing tons and tons of endurance type training. Endurance training will, it does ask the body to become more efficient with its calories, and it also asks the body to become better at what you're asking it to do. And both of those, you do better off with less muscle. You don't need a lot of muscle to have endurance. You just need conditioned muscle, and you don't need, and having a heavy body weight is actually detrimental to doing endurance type activity. So however muscular you are, you'll be less muscular if you do a heavy focus on endurance.
Right.
Now, you have great genetics. You know, you may still be muscular. I know guys who have ridiculous endurance who are more muscular than I could be if I just focus on building muscle. They've just got those genes, man, where...
Well, there's also... And there's still strategies to put in place to help this situation, right? You don't... You're not going to be, there's not like this one answer for everybody. Like, oh, if you do this, then you can be buff and do lots of cardio. Like, no, there's more genetics involved than that. Anything. If you see someone who's like really muscular and they run miles and miles and miles, that a lot of that's genetics.
Yeah.
A lot of that's genetics.
Because I know what I look like when I train like that.
Yeah. Right. So for the most part, running like crazy and doing a lot of those things send a signal to the body that it's not very advantageous for it to have a bunch of bulky muscle. So that's first and foremost. But there are certain things that you can do nutritionally that will put you in a better place than somebody who's just mindlessly running on a treadmill doing something. So fill your gas tank up. I mean, if you're going to go try and train cardio to where you build your endurance, I wouldn't be doing it not fed. I wouldn't be doing it with, you know, low carbohydrates in my system. I would most certainly have definitely fed myself really, really well before I go into these types of runs. So I get the benefits of endurance, but then my body at least has some quick fuel, some glucose that it could tap into real fast and utilize. So I'm not just all of a sudden going, okay, I have nothing. I got to convert over to fat. And then my body adapts to getting rid of my muscle.
There's also the other thing too, is you can send mixed signals. So if you're doing a lot of endurance training, you're sending the signal to your body to become more efficient, which will reduce your muscle mass. Send another signal that tells your body you also want strength.
You just need it, yeah.
So lift weights as well. Now, when you're sending mixed signals...
Fast twitch movements.
Right. When you're sending mixed signals, you're not going to get a lot of either one.
Right, you're not going to max out at one or the other.
Yeah, like if you want a ton of endurance, I'm going to be honest with you. If you want a ton of endurance, you're going to have to be okay with the fact that you're going to not be as muscular as you are when you're training just for strength. Just be okay with that, because you're asking your body to do... to do something, and then you don't like what it does, you know, when you're asking it to do that thing. Like, that's part of that adaptation.
Well, the only time, like, and I bring up fast twitch because you know, everybody knows that you look at a sprinter and you just see this, like, raw, just powerful looking, like, strong body. And they do develop and build, like, quite an impressive physique. But, I mean, think about what they're trying to do. They're trying to place down as much force in as quick a time as possible in a short burst. And then that's, you know, so that's what the physicality of that, like, ends up resulting in this, you know, impressive looking physique.
I'm going to focus on whichever thing is more important to me, and then I'll work on the other one. Mm-hmm. So, like, I want to be muscular and I want to have some good endurance. Both are goals that you can achieve. Now, like Sal's saying, each are going to take away from the other one. So I'm okay with that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put all my energy towards one of them at first. So maybe I want to be more muscular than I care about running the mile under 7 minutes. Like, maybe that's what my goal is. Like, I'm like, I want to, but I do want to run the mile under 7 minutes, but not as much as I want to build muscle. Like, I want to be a muscular guy. If that's the case, I'm going to build muscle and I'm going to put some good size on me. Then I'm going to transition into starting to incorporate some endurance training in there. And I'm going to watch my physique because it's inevitable. It's going to, it's, you're going to be catabolic. If all of a sudden you go from not doing any cardio to all of a sudden training cardio for endurance, you're catabolic and you're going to be catabolic a lot more than what you were before. And I'm going to watch my physique and I'm going to still stay, keep weight training, but now I've introduced this endurance training in there and I'm going to see kind of where it starts to deteriorate, where it's like, okay, that's a far enough. Like I'm lean.
Yeah, where's my threshold?
Yeah, right.
Where
right.
I got to introduce more strength training.
Right. And then I'm going to try to do that. Now, if the opposite is true, I care less about being a really muscular guy, then I'm going to go after my endurance goals. I'm going to get after that 7-minute mile or whatever my goal may be, you know, and I'm going to work on that first and I'm going to get really good at that. And then I'm going to start applying things that are going to help me build more muscle and incorporate more of that into my training.
Yeah, your body wants to become specialized. If you focus it to be specialized, you'll get a lot of that particular goal that you're looking for. But if you ask your body to be generalized, you'll get a little bit of each of those things. So a good example is, think of a vehicle. You are building a vehicle that goes off-road and races on a racetrack. So what is that vehicle going to look like? It's not going to be as good off-road as a dedicated off-road vehicle, and it's not going to be as good on a racetrack as a dedicated racetrack vehicle. It'll do decent. Dude, at both of them.
A perfect example is CrossFit.
Yeah. Yes.
CrossFit's perfect. There's not one CrossFit athlete that is going to beat an endurance runner. There's not one CrossFit athlete that's going to beat a Olympic lifter. They're not. Mm-hmm. The best. If you're looking at the top 10% of those categories, there's not one that's going to beat in either category. But there's a lot of CrossFitters that could do really well with some power lifters and still do pretty well with some endurance runners.
Right.
But they'll never be the top of their class in that, and that's what you get. And then the ones that you look at that CrossFit, okay, that are look amazing aesthetically, well, those people are genetically that way. Genetically, that guy or girl probably looked pretty close to like that before they even got involved in it. It just evolved their physique even more. So I think we have a perfect example.
They're a Swiss Army knife of athletes.
Put that on a shirt.
They got the spoon, the screwdriver.
Can we make that spoon. CrossFit, the Swiss Army of fitness.
Swiss Army knife of fitness. Somebody needs to make that meme.
I like that. Excellent. I like that.
Check this out. Go to YouTube, Mind Pump TV. We post new videos all the time. Actually, recently we've posted a few controversial ones. Get in the comments and have some debates with some of the trolls that get on there. It's a good time.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.